Morning, everybody. It's wonderful to be back with all of you. My wife and I, we did take last Sunday off. We went to celebrate our anniversary, and we did have a good time. Just taking a break away from the whole world, you know, just refreshing ourselves. And so we're a little bit refreshed, I guess. So here we are back into the world, back to worshiping there. It's always good to be back with everybody to worship the Lord. And so may the Lord be with us here today as we worship Him. I also want to give thanks to the church for your support in regards to our celebration. For those of you who were able to attend, and even for those of you who were not able to attend. So thank you so much for your support. And so I ask that the Lord continue to bless us with the love and grace that we have for one another. And so I also want to give special shout out, I guess, to Doug and to Patty for giving us a word of blessing on that day during our reception. So thank you most. Okay, so a couple of announcements that we do have here. The church conference is Sunday. Yeah, Sunday, November 14th, 2021, after our worship service this year. And our membership reports, our leadership reports, our pastor salary evaluation must be completed by this time. Now, the nominating committee, we did meet yesterday to talk about our leadership for this coming year. For the most part, we have decided to keep everything as is. If you don't hear from us, it's because we have not made any changes. If you do hear from us, it's because some people have requested to remove the position, and so we need to shuffle some people around, things like that. So the first step will be contacting you. Will be Linda, who's part of our nominations committee. So like I said, if you don't hear from us, then you're doing the same position as this year. And so if you have any questions or anything like that in regards to these voluntary positions for leadership in our church, please do feel free to let me know. And I'll answer those questions to the best of my ability. And so, yes, the nomination committee did meet yesterday. And then also the trustees are still looking for secretary and a vice chair. And so if you are interested in this, please either let myself know or let Jeremy know. Jeremy is our chair for the board of trustees. We're also looking for people to help serve during coffee hour. There is a sign-up sheet in the back that you can sign up with, or you can see Alma or show up for more information in regards to this. November 7th, next Sunday, will be a celebration of Pastor Cheng's citizenship. It will be a combined service with a potluck following. So please come and celebrate with us. Now, typically, we have our All Saints Monday during that week, too, but since we're having that, is everybody okay with us just postponing our All Saints Sunday to the first week of December? So that way, we can do it together with our moms during the combined service. So if you're okay with that, so I will postpone our All Saints until at least December.
Did you get a check?
They were voting for it the other day. I don't know if. Yeah, I don't know if they actually made a decision yet or not. So, John, Randy, do you guys know anything about that? John's our treasurer, and Randy's part of the SPRC.
They made a decision.
They made a decision. Okay. So they did. So do you know when the new janitor will be started? So we did get a new janitor, so that's what's not in here anymore. And then we are still collecting recyclables for the Hyper Project and bringing them to church and giving them either to Micah or Jeremy. So see the going further for more information on recycling. Okay, now this time, if anybody else has any other announcements, please feel free to make comments. So just to recap, I don't think that this Wednesday there will be choir practice, and you will not be singing this coming Sunday, but afterwards you will be singing.
Yes, the skeleton came doing Christmas magic, crying.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
The Lord is our refuge, and He is our strength.
Very present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we do not fear.
The Lord has made an everlasting covenant with us.
Help us, Lord, to be your people in this world of trial and trouble.
O God, we have come to embrace the gift of salvation that you have given to us. We start your hymnals to page 140. Page 140. Great is thy faithfulness. Lord, how beautiful you are, how great you truly are to us in the faithfulness. Even in times in which we struggle and we stumble, Lord, you continue to be faithful to us. You continue to hold us up. We thank you so much. Today, as we gather to worship you, we ask for your presence. We ask for your Holy Spirit to be with us, to empower our hearts, our minds, to receive you on this day, to grow in our faith, to mature in our faith. And so we lift up one ear up to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. You may be seated, and we hear the righteous prayer. Stand with me if you're able to. Turn your hymn notes to page 147 for the center hymn. Keep all things right.
Thank you.
wants to go trick-or-treating tonight at home. And anybody else that has any joys or concerns at this time, please share this.
We just got notice on Larry's phone that his sister has been taken to the hospital in Kansas City. And so, and she's been in a nursing home for a while with many problems, so he just left, but he'll be back.
Is that Larry talking about?
Yeah, it's his sister in Kansas.
I've told all of you, some of you all, but God comes to us in many ways. And when I got to pick up my car in Sacramento Friday night, I had written down exactly where it was to the letter, the number of cars it was in, and everything. It should have been very simple. But I got there, and it wasn't there. And there was a young man and a woman that were the last people to get off the bus, and I was just right there with them. And he helped me down with my bag. And then I said, I can't find my car. Well, for the next 20 or 30 minutes, he and his wife went everywhere around that huge place where the cars is, trying to find my car. And finally, I thought they were maybe going to say, we'll take you home and come back with us. We'll come back in the morning. But finally, he found my car way over on the other end of 42C. Why it's that long, I don't know, but God was so gracious to send me two people, young, who could find my car.
Praise God.
I have something. First of all, I just would like to thank those of you that came last Sunday in that terrible rain to our service. It was a very nice service. That Patty did such a lovely job on the sermon, and appreciate that, Patty, and Ellen, who stepped up to the liturgist. So anyway, just thank you for doing what you did. And then a couple of prayer requests. A friend of mine, Cheryl Turnbow, I don't know if any of you know her, but she and her husband were in a very serious car accident in close to a few days back, and both of them are hospitalized. Her husband, the last I heard, was still unconscious. That may have changed, but it sounds like he has the most serious injuries, but it was a very, very serious car accident. So Cheryl worked in the Palermo school system and also with the library, and I'm pretty sure she's still employed, but I'm not certain of that. But at any rate, prayers for the Turnbow family and for their children and their extended family. And then I did talk to Ginger last week, and she said she had a bit of a setback. We kind of exchanged voicemails, so I didn't talk to her personally. But anyway, she had a little bit of a setback last week, but is doing better. But they've had an outbreak of COVID at the care center, so she is not able to have visitors. So, you know, I think it's probably really hard for her to be so isolated. Anyway, just prayers for her continued healing. And so there's just a little update about Ginger.
Is Ginger using her cell phone?
Yeah, I talked to her.
Okay. A couple of phrases, I guess. But I was going to tell Jolene, we know of your situation. Came back from Hawaii one time, and we had not written down where our car was. It was 2 hours going down. We weren't here last Sunday, and I went to Dunsmuir through a horrible rainstorm. There was a big wreck going southbound, so I was glad we were going northbound. And came back on Sunday through that horrible rainstorm. But in the meantime, we had nice weather, and we had a fantastic 50th year class reunion. Of 56 graduates, we had 19 of us there, plus spouses and stuff. And considering that
So it's good to touch, touch with people that we haven't seen for a long time. And that's, I never knew happened in high school. I was pretty naive. Still naive. And then yesterday, we had a silent Halloween film with live organ accompaniment at the State Theater. And they had 100 people, but it was a great time. Everybody enjoyed it. So hopefully, if we do this again, more people will show up.
Bow our heads before you once again, knowing that you are an awesome, wonderful, holy, perfect God. And also a God that is full with grace, full with love, full with blessings. You continue to show your mercy upon your people. You continue to bring us here together to worship you. You continue to empower us for the sake of your name, for the sake of we thank you so much for all that you've done for us. You watch over us day and night. No matter the troubles that we may be facing, no matter the pandemic that we are going through at this time, Lord, we know that you're still faithful and you're still here with us, watching us, protecting us, keeping us safe, keeping us healthy at all times. And so we stand in all of all the things that you do. Lord, you know what's in our hearts. You know what's in their hearts. Whether or not we speak these things out, your word has confirmed to us and has promised us and has taught us that you know our words. You know our thoughts even before we know the word. And so we ask that in your mercy, that you grant us the desires of our hearts according to your word, not our own. We ask that you hear our prayers. Grant us our prayers according to your will. And so as your children, we pray the prayer that your Son, Jesus Christ, once taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not.
The New Testament reading is from Romans 1, verses 14 through 17. I am under obligation both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. So I am eager to preach the gospel to you, also who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed through faith for faith, as it is written, he who through faith is righteous shall live. The word of God for the people of God.
So every Friday night, I often spend some time with the youth in Marysville and just teaching them music, trying to get a praise band together there in Marysville with the youth. They do have a larger youth group there. And our youth group used to be pretty large too, because everybody left for school, right? Left for school and left for work this past year. And of course, we had a couple of people that also got married. A couple of our youth that also got married after finishing college. And so that's a blessing for us too. And so for us here, we're still trying to grow our youth group. We have a lot of children here. So or a lot of B teams here at our church. So over here the next couple of years or so, we can grow our youth group. The nominations committee did decide yesterday. When they started the Protestant Reformation. Now, of course, we as United Methodists, we have a history that is a little bit different from those of the Zwinglis, of Luther, of Calvin, right? We trace our movement back to King Henry VIII. And so it was a totally different movement. Our separation came because King Henry VIII, he wanted to have an annulment from his first wife. Because as a king, he wanted to have a son to be the heir to the throne. And his first wife did not have a son. And so he sought out this annulment from his first wife, Catherine, in hope of marrying a second wife so that he will have the possibility of having his son. So that's kind of our history in the United Methodist Church, because we trace our history to the Church of England or to the Anglican Church. And so that was our separation from the Catholic Church. And so because of that, we often approach our faith in a different manner. We have what we call the Wesleyan Water Lavalois. And what we can talk about that at a later time. But today, since it's Reformation Sunday, I want to talk a little bit more about the Reformers. I want to talk a little bit about Martin Luther. How they approach the Reformation. And the good thing about this is that I think it's good for us to explore different ways in which people express their faith. Oftentimes, if we just explore our own way, oftentimes we think we're always right and other people are always wrong, right? And that creates more of a tension, and that creates more division in our relationship with one another. Because we are, after all of us, we are brothers and sisters in Christ. I've studied these ideas and these different ways of approaching the faith, and one thing that I see is that that the United Methodist Church brought our mission that we do, that's good, but there's also things that are not so good. And at the same time, the same thing also applies to reformers. I mean, there are things that they do that's good. There's also things that they do that are pretty flawed. And part of that is because we're all human, right? We're all human, and so no matter what we think of, no matter what kind of system we put together, no matter how we approach our faith, there's always going to be flaws in that, in the way that we approach it. And so that's one of the things that we need to come to realize, is accept that we are not perfect, that we all have flaws, and it helps us be humble, it helps us learn from one another instead of always going against one another. And so that's why I named today's sermon the Pillars of the Reformation, and by doing this, is I'm referring to the reformers, and more particular today, I'm referring to Martin Luther in his Reformation that began on October 31st, 1517, when he placed those 95 theses on the Catholic Church in Wittenberg, Germany. Now, his intention was never separation. He never wanted to separate. What he wanted to do was he wanted to invite the church to discuss these things that he saw as being flawed in the church, and they were. The greatest criticism that he has against the church at that time was because the church was selling indulgences. And he saw this in his own country. He saw this among his own countrymen. You see these people, these rich people, they're able to go out there and they're able to commit all these sins. And the only thing that they can, what they'll do after that is that they'll pay money to the church, they'll buy these indulgences, and they'll receive forgiveness. But then what about the poor people? What about the poor people? What about those who did not have any money? They would commit one little sin, but they would never receive forgiveness from the church, because they were not able to purchase those indulgences. They were never able to give money to the church. And so Luther, he saw these things in his time, and that was his, although he had many other areas of criticism, that was his greatest criticism of the church at that time. Because of that criticism, because of his 95 theses, in which he wanted to invite the church to really discuss these things, but of course, how did the church see that at that time? That was how they were making money for themselves. So of course, they did not like that criticism. They did not want to lose that money that they were able to raise from those indulgences. So instead of discussing these issues with Luther, they put him on trial in 1521. And they put him on trial, and they excommunicated him from the church. And they issued an edict at that time, which gave permission to anyone at that time, that if they were to see Luther, they could kill him without any consequences. And during that trial, as they were asking Luther to recant from what he was trying to talk about, this is what Luther said. This is what he said in 1521. He said, "Unless I am convicted by scripture and plain reason, I do not accept the authority of popes and councils, because they have contradicted each other. My conscience is captive to the word of God. I cannot and will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe." And he knew that he was going to be punished. So he concluded, and he says, "So help me God." "So help me God." And he said, "Amen." And the Lord slowly did. He knew that by not recanting what he was about, by not recanting what he believed, as he was searching the scriptures to understand that faith, or that salvation is by grace alone. It is not by purchasing these indulgences, but it is by grace alone. And when that message came out, the church was unhappy with that. They put him on trial. And these were the words that he said to them, because he was saying that, you know, it's not that I don't respect the Pope. Okay, that's not his point. It's not that I don't respect the councils. That's not his point. But his point was that you see, Luther, when he completed his doctorate of theology in 1512, he was struggling with the Bible verse. That Bible verse comes from Romans chapter 1, verse 17. And in that Bible verse, it says, "For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith." And that word righteous there really, really caused Luther to really stumble on what does that word righteousness mean? What does that mean? Because Luther realized one thing, that he himself cannot be righteous. Because even though he can do all these things that are good, there's always something that he is doing that is not righteous. And so he sees himself that if he was to compare himself to other Christians, maybe he can claim himself to be righteous, but in this context, he is talking about comparing himself to God, and God is perfect, God is holy, and all the things that God does. And here Luther is, he realized that for he himself, he is perfect in the things that he does. And so no matter what he did, he realized that righteousness, it's just not something that he can possess. And so he struggled with that. And he was reading these verses in the Latin language. And so he decided that he needs to go beyond that. He needs to understand what this verse means in the original language of the scripture, which the Apostle Paul was using in Greek. And so he read these Bible verses, or this Bible verse here in Greek, and he studied this Bible verse here. And he studied intently upon this word of righteousness. How can the righteousness live by faith? What is this righteousness that God is talking about? What is this righteousness that is by faith from first to last? And as Luther was studying this word, he came to realize what Paul was saying. It is something that was missing in the Latin language. If we were to read it in English today, we don't really see the meaning of this. If we were to read it in the wrong Bible today, we don't really see the meaning of this also. But as Luther was reading the scripture in the Greek language, he realized that what Paul was talking about was a righteousness that Luther terms that is outside of ourselves. It is nothing that comes from within us, but it's something that is a gift that is given to us. He understood at that point that the only way for us to be righteous is not for us to try to do all these righteous deeds, because, of course, as many righteous deeds as we try to do, there's always something wrong. But what Luther realized is that the only way that we can have righteousness in our life is if God gives us this gift of righteousness. And so this gift of righteousness is by faith, and by faith in who? It can be given this by faith in Jesus Christ. And so it is not something that we buy. It is not something that we purchase. It is not something that we do. It is not something that we don't get money from the church for. It's not something we buy from the church. It's not something we purchase from the pastor, from the priest, from the pope. But it is a free gift that comes from God. And that's what started in a time in which, when we believe in the Bible, we often find ourselves being taunted, right? I mean, we don't, nowadays, we don't go to that extreme of being excommunicated or to that extreme of having edicts, you know, being issued against us or anything like that. But we often find ourselves being taunted when we believe in the scripture as we believe. But today, as we come upon this, I want us to remember our leaders, because tomorrow is also All Saints Day. And All Saints Day is the day in which we just come to remember our leaders, our you know, our those in the past who's affected our faith, who has helped us in our faith. And Luther was one of those who helped us in our faith. Without what he did, without his courage, without what, his bravery, we would not be where we are today as a church, as Christians. But because of his courage, even as he had to live through this, even as he had to live through this, and he spent many of his life in isolation, but yet he was willing to stand for this because he saw that in the scripture. And so when I talk about the pillars of the Reformation, what I'm talking about is I'm talking about the main beliefs or the tenets of the Reformation, which I said is a little bit different from us in the United States Church historically. But yet I just kind of want us to go over it so we understand where they are. People such as Luther, is mainly how the people of them, of that nature, where they are coming from in terms of the movement in the Reformation. And that first pillar that gave that foundation for them to start the Reformation, that they really believed was that by Scripture alone. In Latin, they say, sola scriptura. It is by Scripture alone. And so the Reformers, in response to the Catholic Church at that time, they did reject the authority of the Pope. They did reject the authority of the Church tradition. And so they looked to Scripture as their authority. And it is actually through that pillar, through that tenet of their faith, through the sola scriptura tenet of their faith, which fueled the Church into finally taking the Bible and translating the Bible into all these different languages that we have. Because before then, the Bible was not in different languages. And then it was through this that it fueled this movement to just translate the Bible, because they came to understand that in order for people to know God, that they must know God through the Word. And so it fueled this movement to translate this Bible. Of course, what they're not saying here is the Reformers are not saying that we should not have any respect for church tradition, we should not have any respect for church leaders, we should not have any respect for church policies, we should not have any respect for church governance. That's not what they're saying. But what they are saying is that the Scripture is to be above all things. And even in the United Methodist Church, when we talk about the Wesleyan we see that everything is also based on Scripture. We have tradition, we have reason, we have experience, but then we have Scripture as a foundation. But oftentimes in practice, we don't always practice it in that way. And if oftentimes in practice, we put experience or reason or whatever, tradition ahead of Scripture. So when we think about these things, there's some similarities there, but there are also some differences there. But the first pillar, the first tenet of the Reformation was by Scriptures alone. And the second tenet, or the second pillar, is by faith alone. The Catholic Church, like I said, talk about faith plus works, about indulgences, purchasing these things. And Luther and the Reformers came along and said, no, it is by faith alone that we are saved. It is by faith alone that we receive salvation from God. The third one is by grace alone. It is by grace alone. Salvation is a work of God alone. Salvation is not anything that we do, but salvation is something that context of the scripture, the very thing Jesus was talking about in his status, that this is impossible by man. Jesus was talking about salvation. He was talking about salvation. He was saying that salvation is impossible by man, but with God, it's possible. And so Luther struggled with this, and Luther saw the very same thing, that this is not possible by man, that it is possible only by the grace of God alone. And you know, many times in our Christianity now, we often teach this idea that the reason why God has grace towards us is because Jesus died for us, right? We often teach the gospel this way, that Jesus died and therefore God has grace towards us. But that is not actually the gospel at all. And so, because by portraying the gospel as that, we often see God as this God that is filled with wrath, filled with hatred, filled with judgment until Jesus Christ died. We often see God that way in Western Christianity. But that is not the gospel. That is not the gospel. The gospel is not that Jesus Christ died, so, and then God has grace on us. But John 3:16 is very clear of what the gospel. John 3:16 says, when God so loved the world, you see, so his grace came first, that he gave to God's Son. You see that? So it is the grace of God that comes first, and then Jesus Christ died for us. It is not that Jesus Christ died for us, but then he has grace for us. So there's that slight difference there, but we need to understand, really, Christ died because of the gospel. He died because of the gospel. And that is the gospel we need to share with people. We need to proclaim to people to help us understand who our God is. That God is the merciful, graceful God. From the beginning all the way till now, he has always been merciful. He has always been graceful. And that is why he sent his only begotten Son to die upon the cross for us. And then it goes into the fourth. I've said this many times, but oftentimes this contradicts our postmodern view of truth. Because we often think that everything, truth is whatever you make of it. Right? Truth is whatever you make of it. But to the Reformers, they understood that truth is Jesus Christ. Salvation is in Christ alone. We even see this in the discussion between Jesus and Pilate, when Jesus was standing before Pilate. John chapter 18, Pilate said to Jesus, he says, you are a king, said Pilate. Jesus answered, you say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. And everyone on the side of the truth listens to me. What was Pilate's response? His response was, what is truth? What is truth? He did not know what truth was. But Jesus Christ was saying to him, I am the truth. Just as John chapter 14, verse 6 says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. So they saw this, that faith is in Christ alone. It's not anything else. In the end, the final one is that it is to the glory of God alone. All things from beginning to end is for the glory of God alone. We are not here for the glory of the saints. We're not here for the glory of Mary. We're not here to pray to Mary. We're not here to pray to the saints. We're not here to pray to the Pope. We're not here to pray to the priest. We're not here to serve the pastor. We are here for the glory of God and the glory of God. And once again, this does not mean that we are to disrespect our church leaders, disrespect our denomination, disrespect our pastors. That's not what they're saying. But they're saying that the ultimate goal, above all things, from the beginning to the end, is the glory of God. Everything that we do. And they quote this Bible verse here from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. It says, so whether you eat or drink, small things, or whatever you do, what I often find, what we often find in Christianity is that we often find ourselves either leading way towards legalism, right, in the church, or we often find ourselves leading towards this idea of antinomianism. And these are two different extremes in the church. Legalism is this idea that just puts all this burden on us, that we have to act a certain way, that we have to behave a certain way. You know, you can't dance. I mean, when my old church, when I was growing up, you can't chew gum. I mean, you can't chew gum. You can't do this. You can't do that. You can't go to the movies. You know, some churches will say, you can't go to the movies. These are like all ideas of legalism that we often struggle with. And the idea of antinomianism, which is that we just forsake any kind of obedience to God. We see obedience to God as something that's legalistic. So we just abandon all these things. There's no need to believe the Bible. There's no need to study the Bible. There's no need to listen to anybody. I do as I please. And so in the modern church, we often face these things. We often lean towards these extremes. That's what we do. What we're doing is not perfect. So we lean towards these things. Or we need to be Baptist. We need to be brought back to the center of our lives. That we must be. That we are to be in Christ. And it is in Christ that we receive the salvation of God. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you so much for this day. On this day, we pray that you will remind us and just allow us to reflect upon all of our leaders in the family. On this Reformation Sunday, let us reflect upon reformers. Let us learn from them. Let us learn about them. Bless us, Lord. Continue to bless us that we will realize that faith is in your Son, Jesus Christ, and that grace itself, that salvation comes through your grace and your grace alone. Many times we try so hard to struggle, to strive for perfection, and all it becomes is a burden to us. It's just a burden. But remind us, Lord, that righteousness is something you have already given to us. It is a gift that you have given to us. And that it is through the power of the Holy Spirit that we're able to live out these things. For your glory. And so help us so that we will no longer be striving. Help us to live to your Spirit. So that we can live out. We are once again here page 557, so can you stand? Please stand with me. And do turn your hymnals to page 557. Blessed be the tide of life.
Thank you.
I lost the battery.